quite a powerful story, the story of Mary and Martha. I want to look at that a little bit this morning. But here we see two women, Mary and Martha, in the same situation. Jesus turns up at the house for lunch with the 12 disciples. Who's going to be inviting somebody back for lunch today? Who would like 13 people to come for lunch today? It was quite sudden. Part of their culture is that they were fairly hospitable, but Jesus and the disciples just turned up, and Martha jumps in into work to be hospitable. But both of them were in the same situation. Mary and Martha were in the same situation. Martha chose to be busy, and Mary chose to sit at Jesus' feet. And as I was talking to people this week, I heard person after person comment on how busy they are. Who would say their life is quite busy? It's interesting as we look at this, and as I was praying about it, as I was meditating on the busyness of life in general, when the Bible says my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And there have been times I've come before God and said, God, you said your yoke is easy. What is wrong with you? Knowing all along, actually, the issue is with me, not him. But as I was thinking on this week in the busyness of life, the scripture from Psalm 46:10 came to mind, be still and know that I am God. And it's something we often look at, something we often think about, but it's something we actually need to put into practice. And over the course of this week, as we've been fasting, God's kind of slapped me across the side of the head and said, what about you? Because I know I can be busy. I know I push myself. I know I keep doing things because they have to be done. And in doing so many things, the sword can sometimes become dull. And I love doing woodwork. And if I work in the shed with a blunt saw or a blunt chisel, the work's not going to be that effective. It's going to take a lot longer to do. And so there's an importance in actually being still and just resting. Resting is biblical, isn't it? And so in talking to people this week, in praying and in fasting and talking with our family and our staff, we've all agreed it would be good for me to have 6 weeks off just to have a break. And so that's actually being planned for. That is not a good wish. So this week we're going to be doing some planning towards that so I can actually have a break. And I think it's something that's important. How many would agree we all need to have a time of rest? Amen. So today's message, I'm preaching, and I'm going to put this chair here because it's actually aimed at me more than anybody else. Be still and know that I am God. I need that, you need that, and we need that. It's a biblical principle we all need to apply to our lives. Now I want to look at this scripture again. From Luke chapter 10, verse 38 to 42. Who's got their Bible here today? Read this in your Bible rather than just waiting for it to come up on the screen. It's important we have our Bibles with us. It's important that we take notes, because in hearing the word, in studying what's being said, we need to be able to go away and see, how do I apply this to my life? And your translation might be different to what I'm reading from. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. But you might see something different in your Bible that just jumps out and God speaks to you. So reading from verse 38 in Luke chapter 10, as Jesus and the disciples continued on their way to Jerusalem, they came to a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. Her sister Mary sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he taught. But Martha was distracted by the big dinner she was preparing. She came to Jesus and said, Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all the work? Tell her to come and help me. But the Lord said to her, my dear Martha, you are worried and upset over all these details. There is only one thing worth being concerned about. Mary has discovered it, and it will not be taken away from her. And as I was reading this, I saw a few things as I was studying it sort of seemed to jump out. Martha obviously had the gift of hospitality. Who here would say they have the gift of hospitality? All right, some do it really, really well. Mary, on the other hand, might have had a gift of worship. She didn't particularly want to be hospitable. And Martha was. So Martha was busy doing all this stuff, and she was getting frustrated that Mary wasn't helping her. Now, was Martha wrong in what she was doing? No. The Bible talks about being hospitable. There's times it actually commands us to be hospitable. Martha was actually doing the right thing. So if Martha was doing the right thing, does that mean Mary was doing the wrong thing? No. Secondly, Martha saw Mary sitting at Jesus' feet, possibly a place that she wanted to be. But her commitment to serving the Lord, and keep in mind she was serving the Lord but in her busyness, her commitment to doing that stopped her from sitting at his feet. And Jesus' comment to her said, "You are worried and upset over all these details." The Greek there says, "You are concerned and disquieted. You are troubled by all these details." So Jesus didn't say what she was doing was wrong. He just said, "You're troubled by what you're doing. Your focus is in the wrong place." She could have made lunch with a whole thing of, I'm honoring God. I want to bless God. This is awesome. This is exciting. Mary's being fed. This is awesome. Her focus would have been in a different place. But she was troubled by the work that was before her. And Jesus' response is, only one thing worth being concerned about or worth your primary focus. And Mary has discovered that, and it will not be taken away from her. So again, look at the situation. Jesus and the disciples turn up for lunch. Martha is busy being hospitable. Mary is sitting at their feet. And Jesus responds to her, "Martha, your focus and attention are on what you are doing rather than on who you are doing it for. And because your focus is on what you are doing, you've lost your peace." Mary's focus was on who was in the room, and Jesus said her peace will not be taken away from her. And what I love about this is that Mary's focus was on Jesus. Martha's focus was on work. And when we're focusing on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, he is the Prince of Peace. When we focus on him, the enemy cannot come and steal our peace because our focus is locked onto him. Who's ever heard of Susanna Wesley? She was known as a praying mother. She was married to a preacher named Sam Wesley. They had 19 children, 9 of which died in infancy. So of their 10 children, 2 of them, John and Charles, grew up to shape the course of Christian history and therefore change the world. One of their children was crippled. Another couldn't talk till he was nearly 6 years old. Susanna herself was desperately sick most of her life, and there was no money for food or anything as they were plagued by debt. Susanna worked gardens, milked the cow, schooled the children, and managed the entire house herself. She took her relationship with God as seriously as she did her duties as a wife and mother. Early in her life, she vowed that she would never spend more time in leisure entertainment than she did in prayer and Bible study. That's a big commitment to make. For every hour I watch TV, I will spend an hour in prayer. For every hour that I go out to the movies or to a nightclub, I'm going to spend the same amount of time in prayer. That's a big commitment. And with the busyness of life, she struggled to keep all that together. So her solution was to bring her Bible to her favourite chair and throw her long apron over her head. Every person in the household knew to respect this signal. When Susanna was under her apron, she was with God and was not to be disturbed except in the case of direst emergency. Her son, John is estimated to have preached to nearly 1 million people in his long life. His younger brother, Charles, was very much a partner and vital contributor to these accomplishments. He wrote more than 6,600 hymns, many of which are still in hymnals around the world today. You look at a lady who was busy. Now, this lady had 10 kids. We've had 4. That's busy. 10, I can't imagine. She milked the cow. She looked after the field. Her husband was basically known as useless. He was so focused on what he was doing. He was driven by politics. He was driven by a whole lot of things. Even though he was a minister, things he said from the front upset people. And their house is reported to have been burnt by people in their church twice because they didn't like him. How's that? Please keep praying for me. But there was this whole thing, and in the midst of everything she did in the business, she was schooling 10 kids, she was being a mother, she was being a wife, she had to milk the cows, she had to look after the farm, she had to do absolutely everything, and she said, God, I can't survive without you, so I'm going to give you only 2 hours a day. Who's got a spare 2 hours they can give God? Who would have 2 hours if they sold their TV? Or got off Facebook or social media? There's things we can do. And her choice was, God, in the business, I have to put you first. And so she chose to sit in a chair with an apron over her head and said, this is how I will do it. And if anybody interrupts me, heaven help you. Unless it's an emergency. And we can be doing things and being busy, but we still have to put God first. So Susanna, like Martha, was busy. She was busy doing things. But like Mary, she still chose in her busyness to focus on the one who brings peace. So we're going to do a bit of a game around the tables. There's a few sitting at the back as well. You can do it just where it is. I want you to grab a partner. So pair up with somebody now, and I'll give you further instructions. You'll need to sit opposite this person and face them. Now, who's ever played the staring game? Now, the catch to this is the first person to break the stare loses. And you can make them laugh. You can do whatever you want. Some people can be quite good at this game, so we're going to try and speed it up. So stare at the other person until somebody blinks or laughs. Who's already lost? Who won? That's probably a better question. Yeah. All the competitive people come up. All right, we'll leave it there for a minute. Who knew what else happened in the room while you were staring? Why do you have no idea of whatever else happened? Because you were focused on something. There's actually a good video clip I was going to include that's you've got to watch how many times the basketball is passed amongst, I think it's the white players on the team, there's white and black players. And while all that's happening, somebody dressed up as a bear starts moonwalking through the whole thing. And you do not see it because you are focused on something. Isaiah 26:3 says, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed or fixed on you. And it's easy in our busyness to have our focus somewhere else. Now, the word mind means attitude or inclination, a person's natural tendency. You will keep him in perfect peace, the person whose natural tendency is to have their mind fixed on God. Whose natural tendency is it to fix their mind on God when something's wrong? Most of us don't. And the reason this is important is because that word stayed means established, which means to build. This isn't something that happens naturally. This isn't something that we just fall into and it just happens. We have to choose to fix our mind on Jesus. When you are playing this game, you are choosing to keep your eyes open. The key to that game is to actually relax your eyes. You can keep them open longer. But to not stress over what you're doing, but to choose where you look. The whole thing is a process or a journey. I remember one day when I was working with Fred, he said, think of how long a job is going to take and then double it and you'll be close to accurate. Sometimes it's triple. We think, oh, this won't take too long. But it's a journey. And we have to allow that to be a journey. Now, this verse, who's ever heard this verse before? Besides Bernie, who knows what's the next part of this verse? Because here, there's a comma, which means it's not finished. You'll keep him in perfect peace, whose natural tendency is to fix your mind on you because he trusts you. We have to trust God. When we trust God, it's easy to fix our mind on him. When our kids are upset, when something's happened, they run to who? Mum and Dad, because they trust you. We need to do the same. We need to fix our mind on Jesus. Jesus reminded Martha and Mary, reminded Martha that Mary's focus was on him, that her focus was in the right place. And because of that, she could not lose her peace. So our goal in all we do is to build that continuous response, to choose when I'm in struggling, when in trials, to choose to take time out and say, God, I will focus on you. And that's part of the reason we did the fast this week, because in all the change God wants to bring, he wants us to put our focus on him. Psalm 34 verse 8 says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Again we see, blessed is the man who trusts in him." It reminds us to focus on God, and it starts with taste and see. Who has a favorite food? Who has a worst food? Zucchini. Zucchini's all right. Brussels sprouts might top it for me. Now, why do we have taste buds? Why do we have taste buds? To discern, to experience what we're eating. To discern what we're eating, if it's good, if it's bad, if we should eat it or we shouldn't eat it. So again, around your table, I want you to pick a person, and I want you to think of a food that you like or dislike. Don't tell them what the food is. Now try and explain what that food is and see if they get it. We won't take too long on this. Choose a person at your table, think of a food you like or dislike, and try to describe it to that person. Go. How's everyone going? Who was able to describe their food and have it guessed? Right, Bernie, I heard you saying, "I hate these things." What food were you describing? Raw onions. Now, in describing raw onions, can you think what it tastes like? Can you almost taste it? I'll go with Inika because she likes chocolate. Can you almost, you know what it tastes like by thinking about it? Why? You've had it, so there's been an experience. It's created something within her, a memory and experience of focused. It's so important that we taste and see that the Lord is good. Because when we taste, when we experience God's goodness for ourselves, then we have our own experience to relate to. I get frustrated when I see so many miracles on TV on the other side of the world. I want them here. And when I'm praying for a miracle, I want it here. And the whole thing of taste and see. My dad was healed of a spine condition when I was a young boy. His spine was totally worn out. He was bedridden. He was prayed for at a meeting, and he went back to the doctors. They redid the x-rays and said, "This is not the spine of the person we saw last month." Totally healed. I have seen God work. And I will never give up the fact that God wants to continue doing things in our lives. We need to be pressing in and saying, "God, I want more of you." And when we taste God and we see his goodness, just taste and see the Lord is good. It needs to be something that's a regular part of our life, that's real to us. And I love the last part. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. We don't always see what we're praying for straight away. Sometimes it could be a long time. Sometimes we may not see it in this life, but we have to trust in the whole process that God is still God, because we have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. So what have we looked at? Mary and Martha and the 12 disciples and Jesus all had lunch together. Same situation for Mary and Martha, but they responded differently. Jesus said, "You've lost your peace because you were distracted, because your focus and attention were on what you were doing rather than on who you were doing it for." Mary's focus was on me, and because of that, her peace could not be stolen from her. When our focus is on Jesus rather than things that distract us, the enemy can't steal that, because he is the Prince of Peace and we are engaged and focused on him. Susanna Wesley modeled this, and we see the ongoing fruit that came from the life of putting God first, particularly in her sons, but it's affected the whole world. Isaiah 26:3, "You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is fixed on you," or whose natural tendency is to fix their mind on you, because he trusts you. And again, it's important to remember, this doesn't come overnight. We have to choose to work at this. This may not come naturally, but God will keep you in perfect peace, those who fix their mind on him. So choose not to fix your mind on worry. Choose to fix your mind on him, because that's where your peace will come from. Psalm 34:8, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him." And this last verse again, "Be still and know that I am God." And again, the rest of the verse has, "I will be honored by every nation. I will be honored through the world." If you read the context around this verse, this isn't David sitting at home just having a quiet time with God. The verses around this seem to indicate turmoil and battle and all these things. And the Greek for "be still" means stop. It's a command. And we often look at this as a worship song, "be still and know that I," and it's great, it's important, and we need to have that focus on God. But the command is stop. I will be honored in every nation. I will be honored throughout the world. Stop trying to do it yourself. And that was something, as I read it, that God was saying to me, you don't have to do everything yourself, because I want to do the work. And sometimes we say, "God, you just sit over there and I'll call you when I need you." But he says, "I am with you always. I will never leave you or forsake you." That Acts 1:8, "You will take on power when the Holy Spirit is superimposed over you." God does not intend us to walk this journey and do ministry on our own. And while it's good to take time out and recharge, we need to do that because we are human, we still need to say, "God, I will do this in you." Be still and know. Be still and experience that he is God. Because he is the one who wants the glory in everything we're doing. In the turmoil and distractions we face, God wants us to shift our focus on him. And when our mind is fixed on him, he will keep us in perfect peace. Amen? So just around your tables, there's a few questions on your tables, some discussion time. We won't go for too long. You probably won't get through all of them. Just for a few minutes, start looking through some of those questions, talking through them. What does God say to you through this? What can you teach others through this? What can you learn from this? So have that conversation, and then we'll jump to point five when I let you know. We'll do communion at our tables as well. So just for the last couple of minutes, we'll jump straight to the last question for communion. So I just want to have somebody at the table read through the verse, and then just spend some time praying with each other for some of the things. I know being still isn't always easy. Some of us may need help in that. Some of us may say, "I'm struggling to make decisions in this. Can you pray for me in this?" You may not want to be that open, but take this time to pray for each other. Communion is more than just having a biscuit and juice. This is part of the koinonia, as Michael spoke about last week, part of a bigger community of God. And as we have communion, we remember what he has done for us. So spend a few minutes praying with each other as part of this as well. Just as we finish up, I'm just going to ask if the ushers can take up the tithes and offerings. I forgot to do that a bit earlier. But it's good for us to give to God as a part of our worship. So just as they're doing that, we'll pray, and then we'll pray to wrap up the service. If you're praying with somebody, feel free to continue praying. God can hear your prayers while I'm talking. So well, let's just pray together. Father, we want to thank you for who you are, for everything you've done for us, for your blessing on our lives. Father, we thank you that we can give, Lord, to you. We want to be a part of your work. So Father, I pray your blessing upon the gift and the giver this morning. Lord, use these finances for your glory. Father, give us wisdom to know what to do next. Lord, we want to thank you for every person here. I thank you for every family here, as we've already prayed. Father, we just pray that you will continue to lead us, that you will continue to guide us, that you will continue to orchestrate our steps, that you will give us God moments with people during the week, that as we talk to people, that we can reach out and speak life into them. And Father, when we're on our own, to have that time where we can be still, where we can stop and let you be God. Father, we ask that you just bring healing to those who need healing. Lord, I pray that you just let this week be a week where we can just glorify you and honor you. Father, as we do life together, as community, as families, as individuals, Lord, let us be a people that reflect you to everyone around us. We pray these things and we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Have a wonderful week. Michael preached on community last week. Invite somebody around for lunch this week if you're not doing anything, or connect with people beyond what you would. This is the last day of the fast. Some of you may not be eating, but have a wonderful week and continue to live your life with God at the helm. Amen. God bless. With one word, the mountains move. When you